Thousands of documents from inside the tobacco industry have surfaced over the past year. Documents that appear to confirm what a former U.S. Surgeon General and the current head of the Food and Drug Administration have been saying. We learned of a tobacco insider who could tell us whether or not the tobacco industry has been leveling with the public. That insider was formerly a highly placed executive with a tobacco company. But we cannot broadcast what critical information about tobacco, addiction, and public health he might be able to offer. Why? Because he had to sign a confidentiality agreement with the tobacco company he worked for. The management of CBS has told us that knowing he had that agreement, if we were to broadcast an interview with him, CBS could be faced with a multi-billion dollar lawsuit. The fact is, we are not allowed even to mention his name or the name of the company he worked for. And of course, we cannot show you his face. And your confidentiality agreement with is still in force?
Yes, it is.
So what are they going to do? Sue you for making this appearance?
I would bet on it.
The former executive has reason to bet on being sued for major cigarette manufacturers.
Hello and welcome to Book vs. Movie. This is a podcast where we read books that have been adapted into movies, and then we try to decide which we like better, the book or the movie. I am Margot P. of ColoniaBook.com, and this is my good friend and co-host, Margot D. of Brooklyn Fit Chick.
Hi, everyone.
It's spring. We both have terrible allergies. Sorry in advance if we sound stuffed up or
nasally,
or gravelly. Yep, sorry. I am very excited to talk about today's movie, which is not actually based on a book. So here's the thing. What do we call this now? The new normal?
Yeah.
When the new normal descended upon us, Margo and I decided to do a brand new episode every single week, which means we're not always going to be able to do The Phantom of the Opera or Les Miserables. We're doing most often shorter literary sources. So it might be a novella, it might be a short story, it might be, in this case, a magazine article from Vanity Fair. We are always looking for suggestions for movie adaptations because, again, we're broadening our definition of book to any kind of literary source, basically. So if you have an idea for a book or a movie that you would like us, a book that's been adapted into a movie that you would like us to cover, there's a few places where you can do that and you can interact with other listeners of this podcast and both of us on the internet.
We have a basic Facebook page where all the episodes are posted. Be sure to like that. If you want to interact a bit more, we do have a private Facebook group. And in that Facebook group, it's you just type in Book vs. Movie Podcast Group. We just talk about books and movies. Really simple, really nice, especially everything that's going on in the world these days. You can also try to reach out to us on Twitter or Instagram. At both those places, you type out Book versus a Movie. You spell that all out. And then we have an old-timey email, bookversusmoviepodcast@gmail.com. Send suggestions there. Also, if you would like to get some stickers or a magnet or a coaster for Book versus Movie, we'd be happy to drop them in the mail for you as a thank you.
That's right. And if you really enjoy Book versus Movie and you would like to help keep us in books and movies, you can also join us on Patreon.
Yes, we are on Patreon, P-A-T-R-E-O-N. We put in all the episodes previous to this date and then from 2020 and then I think 2019, excuse me. And then before that, we have about 80 episodes up there. And it just like Margot says, it helps us in books and movies. We have two options right now. We'd like to do a yearly option. We've had people ask for it, but so far Patreon's been a little less responsive for that. I've had to ask a few times. So hopefully we'll be able to do that soon. But anyway, if you are interested, we have some really great episodes. Shawshank Redemption just went up there. Truman Capote's In Cold Blood just went up there. So there's some really interesting podcasts there. And we really thank you so much. And we really just use it for the hosting costs, hosting costs and for books and movies.
That's right. And today, though, today's book, at least, was free on the internet mm-hmm. for any and all who wish to read it. We were saying last week that we had read this article in Vanity Fair back in the... We are traveling back to the 90s today, folks.
Yes, we are.
It was a different time. in the United States. Both the article and the movie take place in the 90s, and there's some real 90s stuff going on that would not happen today, but we're gonna get into it. But let's talk about for those of you who may be younger than Margot and myself, it's hard to explain what American, how embedded in American culture cigarettes and cigarette smoking. What, remember, like in the 70s, everything smelled like cigarettes.
Do you remember like smoking in movie theaters?
Smelled like, yes, and airplanes.
Yes. People smoked on airplanes. There was a non-smoking section on airplanes that was right next to the smoking section. It's astonishing how much smoking there was.
It's absurd. You would go into toilet stalls,
yes,
in ladies' rooms. There would be a little ashtray,
yeah,
connected, and inconceivably in dressing rooms in your finer department stores, there would be a little ashtray in the dressing room when you're trying on new clothes.
I have a good friend that was born in 1999, I believe it was, and she doesn't believe me, and I say this all the time. She always thinks I'm lying. They had a smoker section in my school, in my high school, that you went outside.
I believe
the quad. And that's where the kids went to smoke. And none of the teachers stopped it because they had their own smoking room inside the building.
teachers had a smoking lounge. Yeah, absolutely. And when we did, you just reminded me, and I might have brought it up at the time, but when we did Almost Famous,
mm-hmm,
which was shot at my high school, which no longer exists, but it was shot on the campus of my high school. The opening scene of Almost Famous, he's standing on this wall, by this wall, this white wall, at the high school. That was the smoker's wall.
Yeah.
For students.
Yes. Yes. They had their Nick fits. So that's where they went to hang out. Smoking was everywhere. I believe both of my parents smoked at some point. Definitely my grandparents.
Absolutely. Yes.
Mike
Wallace would smoke through his interviews. And it's inconceivable to the other day, or not the other day, but recently, in recent years, I went to I had occasion to stop in, I must have been desperate with a migraine or something, and I stopped into this liquor store that was nearby in kind of a touristy section of San Diego. And this liquor store was from the 70s, and it had wall-to-wall carpeting.
Ooh.
From this, it had never changed the carpeting, and it smelled like the 70s. It smelled like cigarettes and just unleaded gasoline, and it was just ugh.
It's mid-20th century America, man.
Everything smelled like that.
Everything did.
And we talk about Tudor times and like, oh, what must it have smelled like when people didn't have access to running water? Dude, how about the 70s? Garbage strikes and smoking in New York City. Ugh.
And shag carpeting everywhere, including our van. Everything. We had a van. We had shag carpeting,
yes,
on the walls.
On, yes, the walls and the ceiling. I know. It sounds like we're making this up. We are not making this up. So it was such a serious part of American culture. I Love Lucy was sponsored by, I think, Philip Morris.
Mm-hmm.
And Lucy and Desi would do cigarette commercials, in the breaks of the show. And, very, very powerful. These companies were extremely influential, mm-hmm, in every aspect of American life. And that is not an exaggeration. And if you're our age, you know, like Marco was saying, you definitely had at least one relative who smoked.
Mm-hmm.
And you probably, if you're our age, have a relative who died because of smoking.
Right. Or smoked. Right. I was a smoker when I was a teenager, when I was in college.
I never did.
Good for you.
The years I would have, I'm positive that I would have, but the years that I would have taken it up, I had to have braces put on my teeth.
Oh.
And I thought that was just so uncool. I thought there's no way for me to look cool smoking with braces on my teeth. So I never took it up.
I had it so bad. I was driving my car. I was living in California at the time. I went to San Jose State. And my friends would tell you, the second I got in my car, boom, the cigarette lighter went in. And I was just one of those. Like, it just...
I had friends like that.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
It was... And then...
There was a cigarette lighter in the car, ladies
yes.
and gentlemen.
Yes. That's where you put... That's where you charge your phone now, or you used to use to charge your phone.
That was the cigarette lighter.
That was the cigarette lighter.
That's what that was for.
People got burned. This is what you were supposed to use if you were trapped in a car with somebody. Like, you... That's... There's... Also, we forgot to mention, because I know people who used to make a living at this, working for cigarette companies that sponsored major events. That was a huge part of their marketing.
Oh, and the advertising, television commercials,
magazines,
and billboards.
But like NASCAR,
everything.
All these racing
sporting events. They were everywhere. I mean,
everywhere.
It's sort of like if you picture Amazon.
Yes.
But it's cigarettes.
That it was everywhere. And people knew it was one of those things like young television. I think on the Brady Bunch, they would talk about, no, cigarettes will give you cancer. They're bad for you. Like, we knew for a long time.
Okay. So, yes. So the other thing that we have to, so we're just kind of setting the scene before
right.
we get into this discussion.
Giving context.
Because you have to understand, yes, if you were born, like Margot's saying, if you were born in the late 90s, this is going to be really weird to you. And you can be like, what do you mean they didn't know cigarettes were bad for you? And the thing was, yes, everybody knows cigarettes. Like, first of all, you're putting something in your mouth and setting it on fire right. and breathing it in. You really think like this is some kind of a like longevity tonic? It's not. And it smells terrible. And
your
people
clothes
their
smell.
Houses down.
Your teeth
that smell
turn
was
yellow.
Just everywhere. Ugh. It ages you.
Yes.
I mean, it just all over the place. But people were hooked.
Yes.
And so, you know, collectively as a culture, we didn't want to think they were killing us. Never mind even secondhand smoke. All
right.
The kids who grew up with, you know. I remember like going into, my mom's mom was the one who smoked, and she smoked Cools.
Oh.
Which is what we're talking about in this episode today, specifically this company. And I remember going into her house as a little girl, and there was like a layer, like about from 5 feet above the floor and up of smoke all the time in her house. If she was having everybody over, she would air the house out. But I remember going over there and seeing that.
It's what they did.
More than once.
It's what
that's
you
how
did.
My friends' houses were like that, too.
Yeah.
You'd go in and there would be the level of smoke.
You could go to dinner
really
and
weird.
Somebody at the next table would light up a cigarette. The second you were like ready to eat your meal, they were done. So they were having a cigarette. It's just...
It sounds absurd.
I know.
It sounds absolutely absurd. Especially then when you read what we're going to talk about right now. So
right.
this... So it seems inconceivable that this poor man and the information, the scientist and the information that he was sharing was so like groundbreaking and earth shattering. How could we like we knew that's the thing is we knew we were just pretending like that wasn't actually the case.
Right.
And it took this guy putting everything in his whole life and destroying his life and blowing it up for us to finally see the light. So let's talk about, it's interesting because the Vanity Fair, it's a weird sequence of events. You have Jeff Wigand, who is a scientist. He will talk to how he kind of falls into the 60 Minutes producer.
Mm-hmm.
So he's talking to the 60 Minutes producer and all the machinations, which we'll get into in a minute. This article, which the movie is based on, is written after all of this stuff happens. And I think even after the interview aired, it was weird. No, people didn't really understand at the time. Why did you basically like 60 Minutes? Why did you air this story twice? And why didn't you air this interview the first time you aired this story? Like what's going on at 60 Minutes? That was a whole other earth shattering thing. So the magazine article is written after the interview aired and after a lot of stuff happens. So, the sequence is a little bit like, it's not linear. It's mm-hmm. a little bit back and forth.
It's intense. I don't know how you feel. Like, I read this article the first time. I've read it twice. And the first time, it was in the middle of the night and I couldn't sleep. So I was like, oh, I have this homework.
It'll keep you up.
Yes, it kept
please
me up.
Don't read it at night. Yes.
It's very intense. Jeffrey Wigand is a very intense person. So Marie Brenner is our writer. She's a very successful writer. She wrote The Ballad of Richard Jewell, which turned into a movie. She's been with Vanity Fair for a long time. She wrote for Boston Herald. She's from San Antonio, Texas. She's just very successful. She has a great story about 1991. Then Donald Trump, before he became president, dropped a drink on her because she wrote an unflattering article about her. She's been in the business for a while. And she writes this story where there's this man, Dr. Jeffrey Wigand. He's done this expose for 60 Minutes. And now he's dealing with the repercussions of it. And he's a very intense man. He's somebody, like, he hadn't learned to manage his stress well. He's somebody who's in his mid-50s and the mid-90s, and, it, you know, everything's hitting the fan, and he's not managing it all that well. And he has this reporter following him everywhere he goes. He's a very intelligent man. He's from the Bronx originally.
He's brilliant.
He lived in Japan
very
for years.
Very gifted scientist.
Yes.
Yeah.
He lived in Japan for years, was fluent in Japanese. And then he went through one marriage, and then he had a second marriage. And then in that marriage, he worked for healthcare companies. That's what he did with his mind, with his degree. And then one of his daughters needed a lot of medical care. And so he was looking for high paying jobs. Like, what's a high paying job that I can be home by 5 o'clock? And he got one at Brown and Williamson. Is that the name of the company? B&W?
Yes.
And it's a cigarette company. And they said to him, we're trying to create a safer cigarette. And we'll pay you $300,000 a year, which is, that's a lot of money now to me.
I mean, then
30 years ago,
the guy, like,
yeah,
he's coming from a healthcare background. So, and there's a couple other factors at play. So he's coming from a healthcare background. His second wife,
right,
is from Kentucky. Mm-hmm. And her father owns tobacco land, by the way. And she has a kind of, I may be reading between the lines. This is me connecting dots that maybe don't get connected. But from the movie and the magazine article, you sort of get the impression that she's kind of accustomed to a certain lifestyle.
Oh, yes.
And doesn't seem to have a problem with where that money comes from.
She grew up with it.
But once... She grew up with it. And that's another thing that I think is really cool about the movie. You don't get it so much in, you get a little bit from the magazine article, but I feel like the movie did a good job of illustrating how much, not only did tobacco run the country, but tobacco, like, really was running the state of Kentucky at the time.
There's certain areas like North Carolina and Kentucky that are very,
I mean, and tobacco and the U.S. have a love affair that go back to our inception. It's a long and sordid history. But anyway, he and she moved to Kentucky and they kind of get, like, enveloped into the world and culture and, you know, weirdness of the tobacco industry. Super successful. But he, as a scientist, the whole time is thinking, like, well, I'm here to make cigarette. Like, yes, again, yes, we all know that that cannot be good for you. But I'm going to be here to make it, to make sure that it's a safer cigarette. Like, I want to be a part of that. And for years, he's like, well, when are we going to get to making the safer cigarettes, guys? Like, when's that project launching? Because that's what I'm here for. And they're like, yeah. And they put him off. And finally, they're like, yeah, look, that's not what we want you to do. What we actually want you to do is to make it as dangerous as possible.
Addictive as possible.
As addictive as possible. And I don't care what you got to do. Put ammonia in there.
Right.
Huh. And I guess it's interesting. He's an interesting character because, mm-hmm. like you said, he's a brilliant scientific mind, not the biggest with the people skills.
No.
And not the greatest at keeping it close to the vest.
He doesn't manage stress well.
No.
He has no skills for that.
And apparently the stress... And he says as much in the article, but he doesn't say it in the movie or anything, but you get the impression, like, the stress of, you know, he's been completely hoodwinked. He kind of feels responsible. Like, why did I let myself, like, again, with the cigarettes, like, we knew they were bad for us. Why did we go along with this fairy tale. His, you know, torment about that leaks out of his mouth and he gets fired. And that's when things really start to go bad.
They put stuff like ammonia in the cigarettes. The whole thing that they want to do is try to make them as addictive.
Ammonia, y'all.
Yes. Addictive as possible. And then how can we also appeal to young smokers so they'll adapt to it, you know, and he has a moral quandary about this. On the one hand, he does like the more money. I mean, $300K in Kentucky goes a long way. I mean, and it got them a very nice house. He has,
even now
yeah. It would, but 30 years ago, yeah. And he has one of his daughters has a lot of health issues and they are very worried about taking care of her. And he's an intelligent man, but like you say, he doesn't hold things to the vest. He's very upset when he finds out that they're just kind of using him for nefarious reasons. And so he wants to leave, and they're going to let him leave. They're going to let him go. He has to sign an NDA. We've been talking about NDAs now for about 4 or 5 years. Those are in the culture. This is from 25 years ago. And they said to him, you cannot talk to anybody about this ever. This is just, we're giving you a severance. We're going to give you insurance for a couple of years. It's going to make you comfortable. You will need to, you know, what's the downgrade size. Your life? Downsize.
Downsize. But yeah, I mean, NDAs in some, especially like in the scientific industry, there are trade
secrets
things. Like if you're working for Pfizer and you want to go work for Merck, you know, you can't take Pfizer's trade secrets over there. So NDAs are kind of standard, but in this case, it's like, you know too much. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you can't be blabbing about ammonia in the cigarettes.
Right.
And again, like, I don't, first of all, I mean, I have to say, it's his hot-headedness. It's like, you know, again, the vices of your virtues. His hot-headedness gets him into a lot of trouble, but it's his hot-headedness that leads him to go down this path of, mm-hmm. you know, again, blowing up his entire life. I don't really understand. Like, I can see, and I don't know, because we're getting like second, third hand recall of what happened here. But in terms of like his marriage, again, I don't understand how. Obviously, he's tormented by what they're doing. How is the wife, like, it seems like she is just upset about the fact that we don't get to live in this fancy house anymore. And what is my daddy going to think?
Right. Well, there's that.
I question, but I don't know.
Yeah. It's a second
Nobody
marriage.
Nobody really knows.
Nobody knows what happens within a marriage. And kids change everything. And especially when a kid has health issues, that changes a lot of things. So I don't know. I don't know what puts people together or tears them apart. I'm clueless. But their marriage is fraught, let's just say. At the same time, he is being, and this is very early 1990s, but he's being sent threatening emails. Someone's putting a bullet in his mailbox. There are all kinds of threats. And
tobacco, you have to understand, tobacco owns everything. You call the police, guess who's running the police? You call the FBI, guess who's influencing the FBI? Mm-hmm. So, you know, and if tobacco is saying that you're bad, the assumption is that you're bad.
Yeah.
So, yeah, he is really, I mean, it just sounds so, I mean, it's so stressful. Again, don't make the mistake that Margo and I did and watch this movie or read this magazine article.
Late at night.
It's so tense. First of all, it's tense when you find out what was going on. That is very tense. And then this poor man who, again, nobody is perfect. If anybody had their life picked apart and slanted to make you look bad, it's not that hard to do.
No.
And especially when you've got a couple marriages and you have a hard time managing your anger. It's, yeah. And he, I think it says a lot about him. You know, he had some choices, even in the kind of cornered situation that he was in. He could have sold out. There's a lot of kind of nefarious ways he could have handled that. And he becomes a high school teacher and he loves it, mm-hmm. which I think is kind of great. And after he's lost everything, he's lost his family, he's lost his kids. he's lost any hope in you know, being a big shot scientist ever again. And he really doesn't want to jeopardize this one last good thing in his life. And that, like, he really kind of takes a stand to protect his teaching.
Yeah. He loved it. He was teacher of the year. The kids loved him. Yeah. He gets hired by Lowell Bergman, who is was a producer for 60 Minutes. We should also give some context here. 60 Minutes is a venerated news organization. It's been around for over 50 years. There is a stretch there, especially in the 80s and 90s, early 90s, where it was the number one show. Like, there was football and 60 Minutes and Cosby Show. Like, they were all up there. And then my family, we watched it every week.
It was a limited media landscape.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, it was a limited media landscape. You know, there was CNN, but there was no MSNBC or Fox yet. It was just...
But CNN in those days was basically...
Yeah,
it was. I hate to say so, but it was basically like a glorified weather channel.
Oh, they chased storms.
It was not. It was not the. You know, it did not have the journalistic cred that it has today, and they were kind of a Mickey Mouse operation, and 60 Minutes had a solid decades long reputation. For, you know, kind of like on par with the New York Times, is sterling journalism at all costs, you know, like even if it makes us look bad, basically. They were the source, and they were known, you know, all of their reporters that they had in the stable at the time, but Mike Wallace in particular had a reputation for just like a take no prisoners. Doesn't care if you storm out, doesn't care if you pull the plug on the interview, he's going to get that story. Just this mad dog kind of reputation.
There was a satire written about him. I think it was put in, I read this in college, but I think it was put in the TV Guide, but somebody did a satire of Mike Wallace interviewing a Girl Scout selling cookies. He basically is like, you mean you wear a little green dress and you walk door to door and you ask people if they want to buy cookies and then you take cash from them? And these are strange.
You could ask a question in this way that made anything sound nefarious.
Yes.
And you're like, oh, crap.
I'm in trouble. Lots of 60-minute interviews where somebody will bust into the room like, okay, this is over. And Mike Wall is like, no, it's not. I'm here to interview somebody.
Yeah, he just did not care.
Yeah, they all became famous. Like, they all had their different style. Dan Rather had a style. But Leslie Stahl, they all have a different style. But Mike's was, he's a bulldog. And he's very tough, very entitled. he's, you know, he's going to get what he wants. And Lowell Bergman was his main producer. And Lowell is very... My goodness, this man has multiple Emmys. He has a Pulitzer. He has this incredible background. Mike trusts him. And Lowell lives in California. I'm thinking in the Berkeley area. He lives by the water in Northern California.
Yeah, that was what I gathered as well.
And he was with the faculty at UC Berkeley. But he has a story, and he needs a scientist to help him kind of put it into plain speak, this study. And it wasn't about smoking. I can't remember what it was about. But he basically hired Jeffrey because, hey, can you help me with this so I can understand what this is all about? And, you know, he's going to charge him $10,000 for, you know, it's consulting. And Jeffrey said, okay, I can help you with this, but there's stuff I can't talk about because there's an NDA. And then Jeffrey's kind of leaning into it. Like, I really can't talk about some stuff. In case you're wondering, there's some stuff, but I can't talk about it. And so Lowell Bergman's like, well, what's it? And this is what's also happening in the mid-90s. Late 80s, early 90s, they started putting the warning on the cigarette packs. Remember, that was a big deal?
That was, I mean, it's hard to explain.
It
if you weren't there, what a massive deal it was to put a tiny note that nobody will read on a pack of cigarettes that says, hey, these might be bad.
Yeah,
just
might
so
be.
You know.
If you're pregnant, maybe you don't want to do this.
If you set them on fire in your mouth, maybe don't do that when you're pregnant.
And he's...
Hugest deal.
The big deal. The lobbyists, the tobacco lobby was very, very powerful. And they had a lot of politicians in their hip pocket. This story comes out May 1996, and it's all about the aftermath of his interview with 60 Minutes. It caused a... Because at first, 60 Minutes... we spoil the details. At first 60 Minutes, they're scared of running the interview. They think they're going to get sued by Brown and Williamson, which is very likely.
For their own shady reasons.
Because they're going to be sold to Westinghouse. And so the president, Eric Ober was his name, I believe, of CBS, president of CBS News. He said, okay, I don't feel good about this. Me and our main legal person, we're going to get sued. Let's put him, like, we'll smoke out his face and his voice, and we'll just, you know, we'll have to cut the interview short.
And just show a tiny, tiny, tiny fraction that is not of really any consequence.
Now, this
in
man
the actual show
would give testimony in Mississippi. I had the injunction on him.
This was very interesting. I forgot about this angle about it. So here was the deal with his NDA. There was a tiny little shred of light through it, which was that if you talk about what you're not supposed to talk about as part of a lawsuit, as part of a court case and a deposition, and it's part of the public record, all bets are off. NDA goes bye-bye. You know, you're good at that. But you got to, you know, and fortunately, by this point, there had been several cases filed against the tobacco industry. The tobacco industry had stamped them all out, mostly. But there was this one still kind of slightly viable one in Mississippi that was going on that the 60 Minutes guy kind of rooted out. So, okay, we take him down there. He's going to give this deposition in Mississippi, and then he can talk to 60 Minutes because he'll have made his deposition, and all bets are off. Right before he's so tense.
I know.
Right before he's going to give his deposition in Mississippi, you know, because the tobacco industry has all the power. They have the lobbyists. They have the lawyers. They've got everybody in their pocket. So right before he's going to depose in Mississippi, he's served with, what do you call that? Not a subpoena. Anyway, he's served with a lawsuit or a gag order. He's served with a gag order that's based in Kentucky. So he can talk in Mississippi.
Right.
But if he ever sets foot, but what he's saying in Mississippi is illegal in Kentucky. So if he sets one lucky, they can throw him in jail. You don't see your family ever cease to be in the state of Kentucky.
You broke up a little bit there. Yeah, if he says anything, he can say anything he wants in that suit, and it's public record. But he could be arrested going back to Kentucky. He could be put in jail.
If he even sends a little thought forward into the state of Kentucky, they can throw him in jail.
Right.
Yeah.
So what do you do under those situations? What do you do under those circumstances? And he's like, at this point, he's like, I'm just going to tell it. I can't.
Yeah. Again, he's a little bit of a hothead.
Yeah.
So he's like, oh, yeah?
Yes.
He's got a little bit of that, which is great for America. Not so great in his personal life.
No, his personal life, it is a problem for him. His temper is a problem. His inability to manage his stress. I think he's better now. He's still with us. He's married again. He seems happy doing what he's doing. I think he lives in Michigan now. So fast forward a bit. So he does get the interview with Mike Wallace, and then CBS News comes down and says, you know what? We just don't feel good about this. We're going to get sued. Bergman finds out.
And that could really spoil our big deal that's
coming
up.
Our big deal. And the few people there that work there that have investments in CBS, like, they could make millions from this deal. And so they don't want to screw up this deal. And they also say, we don't want to get sued. And it's, you know, 60 Minutes has been around for decades at this point. Like, they never lost a lawsuit, ever. They were always.
No. Yeah, but this is, again, this is tobacco.
Right.
They've got fingers in everything.
Every pie.
Every single industry, they're in the entertainment industry, they're in the government, they're everywhere. So, yeah, it's like their scariest opponent that they've ever had to go up against, and they back down.
They back down. And Mike Wallace gives sort of like, says at the top, this isn't the full story, but this is what we're legally allowed to give you. And he plays it. And Bergman's mad. And Jeffrey Wigand is furious because he's like, I put my life at stake. My wife left. His wife left him at this point.
Who can blame him?
I would be furious too. Like, you treated me like I'm a chump, and it's like all this stuff. he says things like, oh, CBS, you're 60 Minutes is just infotainment and blah, blah, blah. I'm like, dude, you have no idea what's coming up in the news. Like, that's...
Oh, I know.
Oh, my God. But eventually, it's such a... Bergman is so upset that they put him on vacation, and he essentially quits 60 Minutes. But before that, he starts going around town, and he gives news stories to the Journal and New York Times, and says, you know, 60 Minutes...
He starts spilling.
He's spilling the tea.
60 Minutes is selling out. Extra, extra.
And he gets a guarantee, front page New York Times and an op-ed piece. And it happens. 60 Minutes looks bad. Don Hewitt was a god in news.
Don Hewitt was like, I mean, it's hard to explain.
That's why you need us.
Don Hewitt was, he had this, I remember even like profiles of Don Hewitt. Because this time he's getting up there. Like he's starting to see retirement on the horizon. And he's at that point in his career where it's all about the legacy, right? And Don Hewitt was kind of like the guardian of truth in American journalism. You know, Don Hewitt was he had this image of like he was the guy who was going to stick up for the journalists. Like he didn't care what the commercials were for. And, you know, he didn't care what was at risk. He was always all about the truth and getting to the truth, you know, at all costs. And to spill that Don Hewitt, but when it came down to it, Don Hewitt was also all about CBS. Mm-hmm. And when it came down to this might blow up CBS, which is sort of how he says he saw it, he chose CBS over the truth. And yeah, so Bergman went to all the other big paragons.
He set the house on fire. Basically, he went to the New York Times. He went to print to show them, because 60 Minutes at that time had 30 million viewers on the reg, and they were considered.
They had the biggest, you know, quote unquote circulation, you know, more than any of the big print folks. But all the big print folks together.
Yeah.
That's a different story.
And in New
York.
Now
you're talking to the industry too.
Yeah.
And in New York.
And New York, it's one of New York's big industries is journalism. And so it blows up. And then a few months later, Mike Wallace is able to then finally give the full interview. And it's about 30 minutes. This is all on YouTube. We also posted this in our Facebook page.
It's very easy to find.
Yes.
And again, it is tense.
Yes.
It's so tense because, you know, I remember even at the time feeling like, dude, you're in so much danger. Like, oh gosh. It was so scary.
He was terrified. I mean, the man had, and then Wiki said, like they said to him, the tobacco people were saying things like, oh, he's a little nuts, he's had issues with alcohol,
any tiny little thing that they could blow up, mm-hmm, and turn into something ugly, they tried everything they possibly could.
You smear the person so that you're like, well, you can't really trust this guy.
You had a first wife.
And you had some issues about child support, didn't you? And it's all kinds of, and he's a hothead. He just gets into trouble sometimes. That's part of his problem. Like, you have to be perfect in this world sometimes. And he wasn't.
So speaking of hotheads, we should probably get to the movie.
Well, so let's...
And Mr.
Okay.
Russell Crowe.
Yeah, let's do this. We'll take a quick break, then we'll play the trailer, and then we'll talk about the Michael Mann movie, The Insider, which comes... So I forgot to mention, the article was called The Man Who Knew Too Much. Once again, that's May 1996.
Easy to find. Vanity Fair.
Very easy to find. So here is... We're going to, like I said, quick break, and then we'll play the trailer for this movie.
You go public and 30 million people hear what you gotta say, nothing, I mean nothing, will ever be the same again.
Now, the work we did here is confidential, not for public scrutiny, any more than our one's family matters. We're very serious about protecting our interests.
He's got something to say, he wants to say it, I want it on 60 Minutes.
Maybe for the audience, it's just voyeurism, something to do on a Sunday night. And maybe it won't change a thing. And people like myself and my family are left hung out to dry, used up, alone.
What does this guy have to say?
Now, don't be paranoid, Jeff.
That threatens these people.
But isn't cigarettes are bad for you?
Who is this?
They have no right.
right to hide behind a corporate agreement. He can talk, we can air it.
The worst kind of an organized smear campaign against a whistleblower.
Shoplifting, failing to pay child support.
They can paint everything with that brush.
What are you going to do now? You're going to finesse me, lawyer me some
Mike.
More? Try Mr. Wallace.
If we aired this segment...
I was told...
Don't talk.
Mind my own business.
It could be a grave risk.
We're doing this with or without you, Lowell.
Are you a businessman or are you a newsman? He's only the key witness in the biggest public health reform issue in U.S. history. Does he go on television and tell the truth? Yes. Is it newsworthy? Yes. Are we gonna air it? Of course not. Why? Because he's not telling the truth. No, because he is telling the truth. And the more truth he tells, the worse it gets.
You manipulated me into this.
I fought for you and I still fight.
The American public need to know.
Jeffrey?
And you wish you hadn't come forward?
Dr. Wagland's deposition will be part of this record.
You wish you hadn't blown the whistle?
I think it's worth it.
I told the truth. It's valid and true and provable.
These people,
that's not the point whether you tell the truth or not.
The movie comes out November 4th, 1999. It's Michael Mann, and it's a very Michael Mann movie. It's very exciting. This story about lawsuits and tobacco and guys in cars and then out of cars and there's rain and all this stuff. But it's Russell Crowe. At the time, he was becoming a movie star. He wasn't the big deal yet, but he was in his mid-30s.
Not quite yet. We're still climbing the hill with Russell Crowe. I mean, he's a mega star in Australia, but right. in far as the U.S., he's getting bigger and bigger roles.
Right.
Yeah.
And he's in his mid-30s at the time, which is like 20 years younger than the character. Michael Mann only had him in mind after he saw Hollywood Confidential, that and they had to put a wig on him and age him and stuff like that. And he's like, why are you picking me? But he just knew that he could give the performance that he wanted. And he's fantastic in the part.
It's a great performance. And I have a few like little nitpicky things about this movie, but I'm it's like, for me, it's like just enough Pacino, which we'll talk about in a minute, but his Russell Crowe is fantastic in this.
Yeah.
You know, even with the, when you first see the like aging makeup and the, you know, but the thing about Jeff Wigand is that he's premature, like the stress has made him prematurely gray. He's, you know, and so it kind of lends to that a bit, you know, you don't get too hung up on it, I don't think.
Because he was very handsome. Like he was known, he had a lot of handsome parts. Like that.
He's the right Russell build Crowe. And everything.
Right.
And he really captures it.
Gladiator.
Yes. And another thing is that like, this was a massive blockbuster story in the culture. And so when we saw this movie and Russell Crowe in this role at the time, most of us remembered what that guy looked like.
Mm-hmm.
So it was very convincing.
Yes. We have Al Pacino as Lowell Bergman. Russell Crowe is Dr. Jeffrey Wigand. We should say he's a doctor. Christopher Plummer as Mike Wallace, who's so good.
Spectacular. I kept thinking it was Mike Wallace.
Yeah.
He got the voice exactly right.
I decided to preface Sunday's show. I did 3 minutes on the evening news. You'll want to see it. Where are you going?
I've been banished. In lieu of being fired.
I took off on Tish. I took off on corporate. They'll know they're not going to see everything on Sunday night.
I don't know. How does that get Wigand on the air?
Do me a favor. Will you spare me? For God's sake, get in the real world. What do you think? I'm going to resign in protest to force it on the air? The answer is no. I don't plan to spend the end of my days wandering in the wilderness of national public radio. That decision I've already made.
This Sunday, Wallace will broadcast a report on the tobacco industry, including the tough tactics tobacco companies employ to keep a lid on information.
The arrogance, the confidence.
It's a great performance.
Yeah.
He just so captures. I've seen, there's a couple of things where Mike Wallace is, but anyway, Mike Wallace, again, is somebody who America knows very,
yes.
very well. Yeah, especially at this moment. He just nails it.
Yeah, my friend Maria, who used to get really starstruck when she saw people. She was, you know, CBS is like West 54th Street or something over around there. She saw Mike Wallace and she went, "Hey, Dan, how you doing?" Because she mixed his name up, Dan. And Mike Wallace just like totally was fine with it. He just kind of rolled his eyes like, yeah, whatever. But anyway, people knew who these men were. These were newscasters and people knew who they were. Diane Venora as Leanne Wigand. So they changed her first name. I think it's Lucille or Lucita.
It's like Lucretia.
Lucretia, I think you're right. Yeah. Don Kentucky Hewitt is...
name? I don't know.
Yeah. They had a very fraught relationship, so I think they just wanted to... Don Hewitt is played by Philip Baker Hall, which I'm always excited when I see Philip Baker Hall. He just...
He's great.
He's always he's good. Lindsay Cruz, Krause is playing... I think she's playing the wife of Lowell Bergman at Wife of Hal Pacino. Is that Lindsay Krause's part?
Yes, I believe so.
Women serve to, like, help the men in this movie. This is...
Yeah, it was another time.
It was another time. Debbie Mazar... Love Debbie Mazar. Just think she
They didn't use her enough.
No.
Yeah. I say just enough Pacino, not enough Mazar.
Yes. Movie. We have Stephen Tobolowsky as the CBS News president. He's always great. Colm Feore as Richard Scruggs. Bruce McGill as the Mississippi lawyer, Ron Motley, is so... The scene...
Great.
Where
it's great.
He tell like because they're trying Wings Hauser. I think it's Wings Hauser or Cole Hauser. One of the Hausers is like, "You can't talk, Jeffrey." Like, just so you know. And Bruce McGill just releases just his inner D-Day from Animal House and just yells at the sky. It's awesome.
It's a great scene.
That is correct.
In other words, it acts as a drug.
I object to the form of question.
It acts as a drug on the box.
Object to the form.
It acts as a drug.
Object.
Will you then echo in here? Your objection's been recorded. She typed it into her little machine over there. It's on the record. So now, I'll proceed with my deposition of my witness. Does it act
Dr.
as a
Wigand,
drug?
Dr. Wigand, I am instructing you not to answer that question. In accordance to the terms of the contractual obligations undertaken by you, not to disclose any information about your work at the Brown and Williamson Tobacco Company, and in accordance with the force and effect of the temporary restraining order that has been entered against you by the court in the state of Kentucky. That means you don't talk. Mr. Motley, we have rights here.
Well, you've got rights. And lefts. Ups and downs and middles. So what? You don't get to instruct anything around here. This is not North Carolina, not South Carolina, nor Kentucky. This is the sovereign state of Mississippi's proceeding. Wipe that smirk off your face! Dr. Wigand's deposition will be part of this record. And I'm going to take my witness's testimony, whether the hell you like it or not. Answer the question, Doctor.
Gina Gershon is in this movie. And as Helen Camparelli, she was the lawyer.
Yeah, is it like their legal person, like the CBS head legal person?
Very 1999, like the thin power eyebrows, suit. Power suit, dark lipstick.
The Patsy from Ab Fab hairdo. Yep.
Rip Torn is in this movie. Michael Gambone is in this movie.
Dumbledore's a bad guy in this movie.
Yes. There's amazing people in this film. And it's a pretty similar thing. You know, he hires him to do the story. And then he says, well, I'm really not supposed to talk about some other stuff, but that would actually be a real story. And then they kind of go into it. And Michael Mann's movies are very action oriented. There's a lot of like interesting shots. There's a lot like they open it up with we're told like Mike Wallace is interviewing not an Ayatollah, but somebody
esque
in the Middle East. And people are speaking Arabic and he has to be blindfolded before he's taken to a location. It's to show us that Mike Wallace is the real deal. He's a real reporter. And when he gets his teeth into this story, because Lowell Bergman brings him in, he's really into it. And he's very charming and and Russell Crowe, his home life is very stressful. His wife is very upset because first he loses his job And then they have to move to a smaller place. And then all of a sudden, the scene with the email is the thing that you're good. You hear, I think it's a sound of like bird wings or something. There's some weird sound that happens.
Yeah.
And you're like, what's going on in the basement? And she runs downstairs and it's an email flying across the screen of a computer. It's like, oh my God, this is 1995. That's exactly.
You would get 4 emails a day.
If that. Yeah. No spam. It was a time like you weren't spammed yet. I just, because I, how many emails do you get a day? It's just so many.
Oh, I don't even know. I have no idea.
It's so ridiculous. But it's like it's animated, this little thing that flies across the room. He has a gun in his house that he keeps. He's very safe about it. He keeps it in a safe in the basement. Jeffrey has an issue and he calls the FBI. I'm being threatened with my life because I am a whistleblower.
And they're like, oh, okay. What we must do is seize all of your files and computer information about the dirt you have on the tobacco industry.
We'll just take your computer
out.
That'll
take care of it.
Yeah. So they take his hard top or whatever that was, the big computer. That's not the laptop, but the big computer. And Lowell Bergman is trying to be like, what are you doing? This guy is trying to help us. He's trying to help America. They're going after the Unabomber at the time, which was a whole big thing in the news. And
that's a whole other thing.
That was a whole other thing. So
that was a big story.
Oh my. It was terrifying. That went on for years. So they didn't have the manpower to deal with this guy and that. And so the FBI shows up and they're being jerks about it. They're just like treating him like he's crazy. And they take away his computer. And it just causes more chaos in his life. And a lot of this movie is just Russell Crowe being terrified, you know, talking on the phone, doing interviews. Like I said, there's a lot of rain that happens. There's a lot of like moving around in locations.
Great deal of rain.
A lot of rain. It's a rainy, rainy movie. But it's really good. I think it
mostly holds up very well. My nitpicks about it are I didn't dig the operatic.
The score.
So much. It's a little much. A little precious. And I feel like we spent a little too much time. Will he, won't he speak to 60 Minutes? Like, we all know he spoke to 60 Minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Must we go through his every deliberation about it? I feel was a little. But all in all, I think it really captures the article, the magazine article, which again is super well written.
Yes.
Please read it. It's great.
Yeah.
But I think they caught they really dramatized a lot of data and a lot of facts and dry legal stuff and put it into like human story in a really compelling way.
Hello, Lowell, Mike, Don. There has been so much soul searching about this Wigand. I've decided we should cut an alternate version of the show without his interview.
So what happened to Ms. Caparelli's checking with outside counsel first, all that crap?
That's happening. And hopefully we won't have to use the alternate, but we should have it in the can.
I'm not touching my
film. I'm afraid you are.
No, I'm not.
We're doing this with or without you, Lowell. If you like, I can assign another producer to edit your show.
Since when has the paragon of investigative journalism allowed lawyers to determine the news content on 60 Minutes?
It's an alternate version. So what if we have an alternate version? And I don't think her being cautious is so damned unreasonable.
So now, if you will excuse me, gentlemen, Mr. Rather's been complaining about his chair again.
Before you go, I discovered this. SEC filing, the sale of CBS Corporation to Westinghouse Corporation.
What?
Yeah, I heard rumors.
Not a rumor, it's a sale. If Tisch can unload CBS for $81 a share to Westinghouse and then is suddenly threatened with a multi-billion dollar lawsuit from Brown and Williamson, that could screw up the sale, could it not?
And what are you implying?
I'm not implying, I'm quoting. More vested interests. Persons who will profit from this merger. Ms. Helen Caparelli, General Counsel of CBS News, $3.9 million. Mr. Eric Cluster, President of CBS News, $1.4
million. I was trying to remember that, yes, this is the movie immediately after Heat. which
I hated
that movie.
I was on a date with someone who was loving it, and I was hating it at the same time. It was so
talk about women just there to serve the men.
And Pacino's performance. Oy, oy, oy. And then he and De Niro have a scene together and nothing happens. It's
nothing.
Nothing. Okay, we'll do that some other time.
So given that.
Right. Pacino, I like in glasses. I like that he's a little more subdued.
He's great in this.
Yes.
I like the relationship with his wife.
Yes.
That's really good.
The house is great.
I think it's a. Oh, I know.
That house.
It's a really good performance. Yeah. I think and I think he's used in such a great way here. I think everybody is cast so well and written very well. Yeah, that's my only the score and with The Firm again, the thing is called The Firm. We don't need to spend four chapters or however long of the movie going back and forth. Is he going to join The Firm? No, he's not. It's a 30-minute short film about a guy who decides not to join The Firm. So, we know he's going to do, we could, but I really liked the way the movie explains without hitting you over the head with the exposition, the ins and outs of this about the thing about having to give the court deposition, which is kind of hard for me to understand just reading it in the magazine article. I don't quite get a grasp of it, but in the movie, they really put it to you in a way that has to do with this guy's life. You're like, oh man, how about the scene? Talk about 90s. He just gets served papers at the gate at the airport, because anybody could just walk up to the gate at the airport in those days, just hang out and serve papers.
There's
the
Al Pacino in the original. In first, he starts contacting him by using a public payphone. And anytime I see people using public payphones, I want to vomit. I just think they're just covered in goobers
and
germs.
Were they the grossest
and,
things ever? They were
cooties.
So disgusting, y'all.
They were so
You
gross.
Do not even know.
And we just held them right to our faces like it was no big deal. I know. It's so funny. I liked also the machinations of showing the side of 60 Minutes and what they were going through. And
me too. I liked that too.
Yeah,
I thought that was really well done.
And they're sort of explaining look, these are the consequences. We have to keep this in mind. There's a lot
of
people
employed
here.
Yeah, and that's a thing that, again, kind of gets lost in the facts and the data in the article a little bit. Yeah, you don't quite they talk about it. They talk about the deal and they talk about how it could destroy CBS and that, but you don't, the movie does a better job of kind of driving it home. Yeah.
We should say Eric Roth and Michael Mann wrote the screenplay. It was nominated for 7 Academy Awards, including Best Picture, Director, Actor. I love this story. I saw Russell Crowe was on GQ had a thing where they interview actors and they talk about their favorite parts they've done. And he talks about The Insider. And he said at the time, the studio, which is Disney, by the way, that's behind this movie, not Miramax, which is shocking to me. They decided to push him for best actor.
Not me. There were no butts. There was not a single butt in this movie.
No topless, no needless topless scenes. No, they decided to make an Academy Awards campaign and they put all of their work into just Russell Crowe and not Al Pacino. And they had talked with Al Pacino and Al Pacino said, no, leave it to the kid. He really did a good job, which is so gracious and so nice of him.
You manipulated me into this.
That's bullshit, Jeff.
You greased the rails.
I greased the rails for a guy who wanted to say yes. I helped him to say yes. That's all. You're not a robot, Jeff. Right? You got a mind of your own, don't you?
Up to you, Jeffrey. That's the power you have, Jeffrey. Vital insider information the American public need to know. Lowell Bergman, the hotshot who never met a source he couldn't turn around.
I fought for you, and I still fight for
you. You fought for me? You manipulated me.
Into where I am now. Staring at the Brown and Williamson building.
It's all dark except the 10th floor. That's the legal department. That's where they with my life.
Jeffrey, where are you going with this?
So?
Where are you going?
You are important to a lot of people, Jeffrey. You think about that.
You think about them.
Thank you.
like you in short supply.
Yeah, guys like you too. Where are you anyway?
I'm on a leave of absence. Forced vacation.
You try and have a good time.
It was nominated for sound and film editing and cinematography, all things that it does very well, and the screenplay, which is really excellent. It didn't win any of them because this is the year that American Beauty was nominated for things, and every once in a while, there's a movie.
That takes everything.
That takes everything, whether it deserves it or not. It doesn't here, but that's just the way it is. He was nominated, but Russell Crowe won for Los Angeles Film Critics. He was nominated for Golden Globes. It made the money back. I think it's one of those movies that it kind of caught on when it was on cable. And it's a good cable movie. You sit on your couch and you kind of just take it in. I saw this, I don't know about you, I saw this on Hulu. And it had like a million commercials, which was really distracting. I kind of wanted to just keep to the movie. Did you too?
No. Yes. No, I watched it on Amazon.
No, I watched it on Hulu. It's for free on Hulu. If you have Hulu, just warning you, they just drop ads anywhere. That's sort of like... But it's fine. I mean, I will pick the movie, article versus movie, as much as I really liked the article. It was really well
great.
Written. Yes.
Article's great. But I agree. The performance is so good.
Yeah.
And I mean, all the performances are good, but Russell Crowe's performance.
It's exceptional. Yeah.
Super good. I think in the hands of somebody else, it could have been. Especially with like the opera going on in the background, it could have just like been, it could have been Heat. That's what I'm saying.
Right. It could have gone,
That way, but it doesn't. Like it's so interesting. Like it's restrained, but then you have these explosions mm-hmm. that happen of him, which are perfectly understandable. Like as the audience too, you're like, ah! Yeah, I would also give it to the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it does. And it does a better job, I feel, of telling the story for the layperson.
Yeah. But definitely, especially if you're a fan of this movie, definitely check out that article.
Oh, absolutely. And it's good. It's really good. You know, Vanity Fair, especially in those days. Vanity Fair.
That was like 90s Vanity Fair was just.
Don't sleep on Vanity Fair.
Yeah. So.
So what are we doing next?
I went through the trouble. So I looked at our list and we've done a lot of musicals lately. We've done some magazine articles. So I was looking back at books and seeing like, what are the page counts? And I have a couple of ideas. How to Make an American Quilt. If you remember that, that's '90s one. It's streaming everywhere. It's easy to get and it's only 179 pages.
Oh, let's do that.
Yeah, that's what I think
that
so too.
Like fun.
Yeah.
After tobacco is going to come for your family.
Yeah. Let's do another 90s thing, but just have it be in a different direction. Women. It's more women centered. So that'll be really nice.
Yes.
All right.
Women things like sewing,
talking, riding in cars and singing along to Neil Diamond. You know, that's what we do. It's actually what I do.
Oh, we'll have to discuss that. The 90s female sing along.
Yes.
Scene.
That was a trope. That was a thing. Be sure to follow us on all the social media things, especially if you have ideas. We should say that it needs to be something that easily we can get. It's on the Libby app or it's on Kindle. It should be or an easy to get paperback. And especially with the movie part, it has to be streaming someplace. Please, you know, send us your suggestions. And once again, our email is bookversusmoviepodcast@gmail.com. Also, wherever you listen to your podcast, be sure to subscribe. And if you like what you hear, please leave us a review. We'd really appreciate that. And we'll mention you on the air. Margo, where can they find you?
You can find me online at coloniabook.com. And all of my social media callouts are at Cheese Nacho Mama. And where can they find you?
You can find me at Brooklyn Fitchick, mostly for Twitter and Instagram. My site is brooklynfitchick.com. Next time, How to Make an American Quilt. Thank you so much for listening to the Book vs. Movie podcast. We are a part of the Frolic Podcast Network. You can find more podcasts you will love at frolic.media/podcasts. We follow the hashtags Lady Pod Squad and Potter and Family. If you want to support the show, you can go to our Patreon page, go to P-A-T-R-E-O-N, and look for Book versus Movie Podcast. We have a basic Facebook page, but we also have a private Facebook group. Go to Facebook and type in Book vs. Movie Podcast Group if you want to join that. You can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Book vs. Movie. Spell all those words out. If you'd like to send us an email, it's Book vs. Movie Podcast, spell that all out, at gmail.com. You can follow Margot D. at Brooklyn Fit Chick on social media, and Margot P. at She's Nacho Mama. Thanks so much again for checking out our show, and we'll be back soon with a new episode.